All right. Little filler. Yeah, it's kind of like a shifting group, so I got a little filler here, to fill in on where we've been for people who haven't been here. I won't give you the whole backdrop because I can't. But chapter 1, verses 5 through chapter 2, verse 3, the man and the woman, they're the stars of the poem. This is a poem, the leading characters, a man and a woman. And there in those verses, chapter 1, verse 5, chapter 2, verse 3, the stars declare their attractiveness to each other. He extols her beauty, says that she stands out among all other women, and she similarly compliments his handsomeness, that he's just great, stands out among all the young men. Then in chapter 2, verse 4 to 7, the woman expresses her eager anticipation of the fulfillment of her sexual desire that will be experienced on their approaching wedding day. She says, in essence, that the wait until that consummation is killing her. That would be our terminology. And so she warns others against getting too sexually revved up before that longing can be satisfied in marriage. As I said a couple of times, what that really is, I think it's a poetic way of emphasizing the strength of her sexual desire for her man. It's a way of, so she's saying that, it's so just overpowering. I don't get into that, you see. So I think it's a way of emphasizing her attraction and how powerful this is. Chapter 2, verse 8 to 17, we see with the wedding approaching, there's a morning scene and a night scene. And around daybreak, the man is portrayed as bounding over mountains and hills like a young stag to see his love. So he's as hot for her as she is for him. This isn't a one-way deal. He's like, pictured as, first when it says a young stag, but he's bounding over these hills and things, and he pleads with her from outside her home to come away with him so they can have focused time together. He wants to hear her voice. He wants to be able to look at her, just the two of them, just to engage her and to be there like that. And he wants this to occur in this delightful setting of a spring morning. He describes how everything is just so idyllic and beautiful and stuff's popping out and fragrances, and it's just this wonderful environment. Come on, let's steal away and let's go to be together so we can just enjoy each other. Now, despite her sexual desire, which has been laid out in no uncertain terms, the woman recognizes that this isolated and prolonged visit that her love envisions in a sensual atmosphere, no less, she recognizes that it's morally dangerous. That they easily could be overcome in that setting by the power of sexual temptation. And as I mentioned last week, that's advice for people. How many young people could heed that advice of saying, circumstances, if you can stay out of them, you can stay out of trouble. You can stay out of immorality. So she tells him, and this strikes us as a strange phrase, she tells him to catch the little foxes that do damage. See, which is a way of saying it would be potentially damaging them for them to follow through on his suggestion. See, these little foxes, they're little things, but they damage vineyards. And so this looks like a little thing, but she says, catch that fox before it's able to do damage, before it's able to pull us into the danger that I see. So she turns him away and tells him to head on back to the mountain. And she does that because the time is not yet right. And I quoted Duguid, where he says that her no is a not yet, my love, not a never. It's just that the time is not yet right because we're not married. So she sends him back. Now, having declined her love's invitation for this temptation-laden getaway, in chapter 3, verses 1 to 5, the woman's experiencing anxiety over losing him, which manifests itself in these repeated dreams that she's having. And you can imagine how that would be. You've got somebody, you're crazy about him. He comes here, this is poetry, understand? He comes here looking for, she sends him away. And then you can see the anxiety that would create. So she not only has this sexual desire that cannot yet be fulfilled in real life, she has the anxiety now of having sent him away for moral reasons, and this is bubbling out in the dreams that she's having. And so the sexual desire can't find satisfaction yet. It bubbles out in her dreams under this added pressure of having properly declined his invitation. Now the wedding scene begins. That's in chapter 3, verses 1 to 5. The wedding scene begins, as I see it, in chapter 3, verse 6. This is a reference to his approaching bride. It says, "Who is this coming up from the wilderness, like columns of smoke perfumed with myrrh and frankincense, with all the fragrant powders of the merchant?" Now, I want to pick back up there. As I mentioned, it's important to see this. Many translations, they're about split. Is this, who is this coming up, or what is this coming up? And I suggested to you last week that it's better to take it as, who is this? And there are many translations that I put up last week that follow that, because the pronoun there is typically who instead of what. Not always. But if you're going to pick, normally it would be who. And also you have this very phrase, who is this? That identical phrase is used three times in Song of Songs. It's used in here and in 6:10 and 8:5. And in the other two, it clearly refers to the woman. So you have this exact phrase three times. Two times clearly refers to the woman. So I'm saying it's better to see it as, who is this? It's referring to the woman. You also have the fact that she's associated with these described perfumes of myrrh and frankincense. She is associated with those in chapter 4, verse 6, 4:14. And the columns of smoke, as I mentioned last week, they're really described as palm-like columns. It's not just a straight-up column. It's a palm-like column. And that's significant because it ties to the woman's poetic description in chapter 7, verses 7 and 8, as a palm tree. So I think it's important to see that's what's going on here. Now, if you take it as, what is this? That's going to have a big effect on how you're going to read the next section. Okay? So that's where I want to get. And this next section is key and probably the most controversial for how I'm presenting this to you. But it says, "Behold, his bed, Solomon's, 60 mighty men surrounded of the mighty men of Israel. All are skilled with a sword, experienced in battle, each with his sword at his side because of the terrors of the night. King Solomon made for himself a canopied bed from the wood of Lebanon. He made its posts of silver, its roof of gold, and its cushion of purple fabric. Its interior was paved with the love by the daughters of Jerusalem. Go out, O daughters of Zion, and look upon King Solomon with the crown with which his mother crowned him on the day of his wedding, on the day of the gladness of his heart." Now, the translation, there are a number of issues here, a number of questionable things or things that people could dispute. I translated it this way. I want to explain some of those things, point them out to you. You can weigh them and see if you think what I'm saying to you makes sense. First here, the thing here is bed. The word metah in verse 7 there that I translate bed, in your translation, very oftentimes, I'd say typically, it's translated as litter or carriage, meaning some kind of portable bed or portable couch, you know, that you could picture a king being carried on kind of thing. Okay, so it's many times it's translated that way, but the word often refers simply to a bed. It refers simply to a bed, which in the case of a king, it's often elevated and made of expensive materials. Here are just some examples where a king's metah is translated simply bed. And so that is certainly a way that that it's used. So then why go with this idea of litter or portable bed or couch kind of thing? Portable couch. Well, it's because of how do you understand the previous verse? You see, if you say, who is this? And the this is feminine. So I'm saying it's who is this? It's who is this? It's a woman. It's the same woman who it is in 6:10 and in 8:5. But if you say, what is this? Matah is feminine. So you can say, oh, what is this? Okay, it's the litter that's coming. All right, so that's the question. I'm going with bed, and I see this section, 3:7 to 11, just as this interjection here. She's coming up at the beginning of the wedding. and I'll tell you what I think's being said here. But first is that question of that translation. And then you have another word. You hear canopy bed. Okay, that's oftentimes translated as sedan chair. Okay, so you've got litter, and if you're going with litter, partly influenced by verse 6, this idea of a portable thing, some means of conveyance, well then this idea of a sedan chair would fit because that's, you know, you're riding in it kind of thing. But this word, this is the only place in the Old Testament where this word appears. And the etymology of the word is uncertain. So when you're trying to determine what does the word mean, they look for other languages. Where did this word come from? Well, did it come from Ugaritic? Did it come from over here? And so then they find a word they think this word derived from, and then we look and we say, well, what does that word mean in that language? And so there's a great deal of uncertainty here. So what I'm going with is there's a fellow, Michael V. Fox, who's a world-class Hebraist, written many commentaries on Old Testament books and things. But Michael Fox renders that canopy bed. And so I think that fits. I'm going with bed, and then you have an alternate. You could go litter or sedan chair connected. Or if you're going bed the way I'm going, well, then I'll go with Fox on canopy bed. And Fox isn't the only one. Jack Sasson, who's another world-class Hebraist, he says in a book that he wrote, major contribution to Song of Songs scholarship, talking about Michael Fox's contribution to Song of Songs scholarship. And he renders it a canopy bed for his own use did King Solomon make with timber of Lebanon. So it's not crazy. I'd say this there's a great deal of uncertainty into what this word means. Then I follow the Common English Bible in rendering this seat. I render it cushion. Okay, because if I'm going with bed, which I think is right, then where do you sit on a bed? People do sit on beds, for example, 1 Samuel 28:23. Well, it would be some sort of cushion, whether it would be equivalent to our mattress, but it would be some sort of cushion. Now, the Common English Bible goes plural, but the noun is singular, so I just went with cushion. And then as Eliasis suggests in his book, Flashes of Fire, A Literary Analysis of Song of Songs, I think this phrase, paved with love, is a metaphor for the acts of love that occurred there between Solomon and the daughters of Israel, daughters of Jerusalem. I remind you, Solomon, in disobedience to God, had 700 wives, 300 concubines. So this guy had an awful lot of ladies. And I think that's what this is about. So what do I think is going on here? And I'm not alone in this. I think the point as I see it is that as she's coming here, you have this break-in to have the people there called to consider the security and the opulence that Solomon offers brides and to think about how that pales in comparison to the rich love and the covenant loyalty that will characterize the marriage of the man and the woman. The young women, they're now called daughters of Zion. These young women who have been around in the background all the time, they're called daughters of Zion to distinguish them from the daughters of Jerusalem who paved Solomon's bed with love. And they're called to look upon King Solomon on his wedding day in light of all the women with whom he shared his bed and to reflect on what really matters in marriage. I mean, is marriage really, in essence, is it about physical security? Because you can't beat Solomon. Solomon's got a whole army to protect you from the terrors of the night. Is that what it's about? Is it about the wealth? I mean, he's got, you know, posts of silver, canopy bed, roof of gold, posts of silver. That also doesn't seem to me like something somebody wants to carry, by the way. But you see, so is that what it's about? Is it about security? Is it about wealth? You see, isn't a marriage with modest means, but genuine love and exclusive devotion, isn't that better than entering a royal harem, regardless of how content Solomon may be with the situation? I mean, Solomon care. I mean, he's happy. Solomon's got, you know, what's he got, a marriage a day going? I mean, I don't know. But what really matters in a marriage? Here's what Dugwood says about it. This is Ian Dugwood, who wrote a commentary that was very helpful to me in the Tyndale series. Just came out in 2015. But he says, if interpreting paved with love as a metaphor for sexual conduct, as Eliasis argues, is correct, then Solomon's lovemaking to the many daughters of Jerusalem in these opulent surroundings would contrast dramatically with the exclusive love of the man and his beloved in the much simpler surroundings. Unlike the bed that belongs to Solomon and the daughters of Jerusalem, the bed of the man and the woman is not purple but verdantly green. That's from a text we looked at before. Its beams and rafters are not made of gold and silver but simple cedar and pine. And that's really referring to the house, but you see the contrast. These simple, strong woods versus this gold and silver. Nonetheless, they're the ones who are building a solid and lasting house constructed from true love, not glitzy, counterfeit substitutes. And I think that's what, and I said, I think in the first week, the introduction, I think part of why we've missed some of the power of the Song of Songs is we've gotten all tangled up with Solomon in it. And as I said, I think Solomon really is, he's the foil here. Now this perspective, if you say, okay, you can argue about these different translations, that you can. But this perspective that I'm offering you on this section, it's in keeping with the negative implication that accompanies the only other mention of Solomon in the book in chapter 8, verses 11 and 12. So that's more fuel for me to think this is the right track. You see, in Solomon, in chapter 8, verses 11 and 12, as we'll see when we get there, you know, they're his business-like harem. That's how it's characterized. His business-like harem, you see, that's attended by others, and it provides him some kind of return. It's like a business. It's this huge thing. Other people manage it and run it, and it provides him some kind of return in the form of political and other advantages. Well, there it's contrasted. It's contrasted with the woman's choice regarding her own vineyard, her own body. And so we'll get to that, but I think this is more in keeping with that. And as I struggled and worked in understanding this, that's what I think is going on in 3711. Solomon is the foil against which the true love of this couple stands out in greater contrast. And so you see, anyway, that's how I see that. Now in 4, 1 to 7, we have the man continuing. He says, behold, you are beautiful, my darling. Remember, he sees in 3:6, as I see this, the wedding scene coming. Here she is. I picture this as every man who's gotten married, his wife, bride coming down, this spectacular scene. And then you have this 7 to 11, this thing about Solomon. And now we're going to get the answer. Well, who is this coming? Well, this is who's coming. It's his bride coming. And he says, behold, you're beautiful, my darling. Behold, you're beautiful. Your eyes behind your veil are like doves. Your hair is like a flock of female goats flowing down from Mount Gilead. Your teeth are like a flock of newly sheared sheep coming up from the washing place, all of them bearing twins. There's not a bereaved one among them. Your lips are like scarlet thread. Your mouth is lovely. Your cheek behind your veil is like a slice of pomegranate. Your neck is like the Tower of David, built in rows of stone. On it are hung 1,000 shields, all shields of mighty men. Your two breasts are like two fawns, twins of a gazelle that graze among the lilies. Before the day breathes and the shadows flee, I will go up to the mountain of myrrh and to the hill of frankincense. You are altogether beautiful, my darling, and there is no blemish in you. All right, so here we have, having interjected by way of this reference to Solomon's splendor and his many sexual partners, having that thrown that in there as a contrast, he then answers the question in verse 6, chapter 3, verse 6. The one coming up from the wilderness is his beautiful darling. And he previously had described her eyes like doves in chapter 1, verse 15. And in doing so here, he refers to her veil. And this is very likely an indication of their wedding. And that's how I see this, is that now we're down to the actual wedding. And so what he sees is this picture of her coming up, coming up there, and he compares her flowing black hair to a flock of black goats streaming down Mount Gilead. And I said before, you know, the imagery that's used is foreign to us, but the sentiment you can see. In fact, I noted here, old song by Bob Dylan. Some of you may be old enough to know this. Girl from the North Country. Dylan's got a line there, says, "Please see for me if her hair's hanging long. It rolls and flows all down her breast. Please see for me if her hair's hanging long, for that's the way I remember her best." And I see the same sentiment. You see, what triggered it? This is a guy who's thinking about an old love in that song. But what does he remembers her hair flowing, you see. And I see that the same thing here. He sees, now you can see like the goats coming down and hear her rich dark hair flowing. This is a compliment to her. We read it and kind of snicker. But it's a compliment, something that has captivated him, and this is how guys are. They are attractive. I think ladies know that. Ladies know about their hair. You know, so this is something here. Now he continues moving his gaze down. He moves his gaze downward from her captivating face. Ah, he says her cheeks are rosy. Yeah. Her cheeks are rosy like a slice of pomegranate. Okay, I mean, we'd say, you know, rosy. In fact, there was a Seinfeld episode where George was asking, "Does she have a rosy hue?" He was asking Jerry, "Rosy hue?" You know? So we still care about that, you see. So here it is. You have this. So this idea of she's got rosy cheeks, and her neck has this stately bearing. And it's decorated with layered necklaces. Well, I've seen people wear layered necklaces, and that's how her neck is decorated, that resembles the rows of shields that would be hung on these stones. So he's saying, you know, she's, as I said last week, she's accessorized in a way that's really dynamite. You know, there's ways you can do that, like, you know, don't really enhance you, but there are ways of accessorizing that are like, whoa. And he's telling her that her taste and her way of accessorizing is dynamite. And so this is part of what's going on. Now he continues moving his gaze downward from her captivating face to her stately decorated neck. And then he moves on down to her breasts. And they are symmetrical. And they move gently as she moves. You see, like two fawns grazing among the lilies. You see, there's just this gentle movement. And oh, he notices. You know, he sees. And so this guy's, he's taken and he's telling her that she's, you know, really nice. He really likes her, likes the way she looks. And at this point, he breaks off his description of his love's captivating beauty. He just breaks that off and he declares his intention to enjoy her breasts before daybreak. This is part of why I'm saying this is wedding day, baby. So he declares his intention. He's going to the mountain of myrrh and the hill of frankincense. Right in the context of talking about her two breasts, he's going to go to the, he's going to the mountain of myrrh and the hill of frankincense before daybreak. So he's going to enjoy her that night. And he breaks that off and he's ready for that. See, he's on the verge of realizing the sexual fulfillment that he's imagined for what seems like an awful long time. And this consummation is portrayed in the next section. Okay, he pronounces his darling, who now is or immediately will be his bride, he pronounces her altogether beautiful. You see in verse 8, which we'll get to, he refers to her as his bride. So she either is now or really soon going to be, like in the next minute, but he pronounces her altogether beautiful, and she's flawless in his eyes. Now there was something I wanted to mention that I'm trying to see if I... Let me go back to 3:6. Because I've forgotten 3:6. Oh, well. You guys got to hang with me here. Oh, yeah, I forgot to say this, because I think it's important. This idea, who's coming up from the wilderness? You say, what's that about? How can that possibly refer to his bride coming up? And what I think is going on there is that in his mind, as she's coming to join him in marriage, she's coming into his household. And I think from his perspective, whether it's male ego or whatever it is, I think he sees in his mind that she's coming from the place of relative insecurity and want, the wilderness, to his home, which is a place of provision and plenty. So I think that's why it's characterized that way. Because you say, why is this thing? And in the poetry, I think that's what's happening. Is in his mind, she's moving and coming into his house and becoming his bride, his wife. That she's moving from what he perceives to be wilderness, relative insecurity and want, into his place, and he's going to take care of her. All right. I thought I forgot to say that. I couldn't find where I had. But there you have it. Burp, burp, burp. Okay. Now I'll never get back to where I'm supposed to be, but that's how that works. Okay, so he continues. Let's go to 4:8. All right, 4:8. Man continues. Come with me from Lebanon, my bride. With me from Lebanon come. So here we see now we have the reference to my bride. Okay, so he says, come with me from Lebanon, my bride. Come with me from Lebanon come. Descend from the peak of Amana, from the peak of Senir and Hermon, from the dens of lions, from the mountains of leopards. You have stolen my heart, my sister, my bride. You have stolen my heart with one glance from your eyes, with one jewel of your necklace. How beautiful are your caresses. And you remember we talked about caresses and how this carries this sense of sexual touching. He says, how beautiful are your caresses, my sister, my bride. How much better are your caresses than wine and the fragrance of your oils than all spices. Your lips drip nectar, my bride. Honey and milk are under your tongue. I know we wouldn't talk this way, you see, but you got to get what he's saying. Honey and milk are under your tongue, and the fragrance of your garments is like the fragrance of Lebanon. A locked garden is my sister, my bride. You are an enclosed spring, a sealed up fountain. Your shoots are a park of pomegranates, with choice fruits, henna and nard and saffron, calamus and cinnamon, with every kind of incense tree, with myrrh and aloes and all the finest spices. You are a garden fountain, a well of flowing water streaming down from Lebanon. The woman, awake north wind and come south wind. Blow on my garden, let its spices flow. Let my love come into his garden and eat its choice fruits. The man, I come to my garden, my sister, my bride. I gather my myrrh and my spice, eat my honeycomb with my honey. I drink my wine with my milk. The daughters of Jerusalem, eat, friends, drink, and be drunk with caresses. Ah, all right, here you see. Now, verse 8, this is the man's appeal for his love to come from a place of inaccessibility to him. That's what's going on here with this. Come with me from Lebanon, these mountain places. It's an appeal for her to come. She has been inaccessible to him. Come from a place of inaccessibility to me. And that inaccessibility, it's represented by these mountain peaks that were inaccessible both because of topography. I mean, unless you're going to be one of these guys who wants to go scale mountains, both because of topography and because of the presence of predators. So even if you were somebody who was going to go out and scale mountains, you'd have to fight off the lions and fight off, you know, the leopards. So that's what's pictured there. It's his appeal for her to come to him from a place of inaccessibility and to join him on life's journey as a married couple. You see, when he says, come with me from Lebanon, my bride, with me from Lebanon, come. He wants her to join him. And this is what marriage is. You know, I saw some article not long ago about some woman who was bragging about how sexually free she was and, you know, slept with everybody and didn't care and all this stuff. And the guy writing the article said, well, I'd like to talk to her when she's 70. You see, and I'm telling you, this is what marriage is. Marriage is a partnership where you journey through life together. It involves all of this excitement of sexuality. All of that I understand. But what it is a journey of two people who go through all of these things together, raise families, deal with sickness, all of these things. It is a life partner who, when you're old and you look, you've traveled together through all of this stuff. It's not to be traded for anything. You see, for anything. And that's his call here. He wants her. And these could be wedding vows. I mean, he's saying, you know, come with me. Come with me and we will begin a journey of life together. And he tells her in verse 9 that she drives him crazy. In a good way. You see, that it was love at first sight. You know, she had him at hello. I think that's the way the line goes, right? He says, you've stolen my heart. You've stolen my heart with one glance from your eyes, with one jewel from your necklace. That was it. You had me, we might say, from Jump Street. I was captivated by you. And in calling her sister, as well as bride, he indicates that his attraction to her is relational, as well as physical. It is relational. You see, it's the idea here that their bond resembles the friendship and closeness that exists between normal brothers and sisters, okay? I know brothers and sisters can hate each other and all that kind of stuff. He's not thinking about that. He's talking about the closeness of the bond that exists relationally. So that's what he is. She's a knockout to him. She's driving him crazy. The way she looks, and as I say, in a good way, he's like, whoa. But there's also this relational element. And you saw that with her as well. In verse 10, he's longing for the lovemaking that he's about to enjoy with his bride as the woman had longed for it. In chapter 1, verse 2. He's longing for this. Though she, at that time, she was further away from fulfillment. This guy's right there. You see, he's right there. How beautiful are your caresses, my sister, my bride. How much better are your caresses. So he's like, just as she was saying and expressing how much she wanted that, he's saying that now, but he is at the door. You see, he's at the door. This is the wedding. And so then in verse 11, he depicts just this sensual carnival he experiences as, in my judgment, as they engage in foreplay. This is simply this sensual carnival he's painting here. The aromas are wonderful. Her lips and her kisses are sweet. Like I said, we wouldn't talk that way if we wanted to say, you know, man, I just wanted to eat her up. I mean, she was so sweet. No, that's how they're going to say it. But that's what he's talking about. You see, it is a sensual carnival. And he's trying to express that. And that's what he's experiencing and going through. Like I said, the aromas are like just great. Her lips and her kisses are like unbelievable. And so he puts it out this way. Now, verse 12, it portrays the fact she's a virgin. This should come as a surprise to no one who understands Scripture. She is a virgin. You see, that would be something that she had, until now, she had been closed to all others. That's what's going on here. A locked garden is my sister, my bride. You are an enclosed spring, a sealed up fountain. She had not had sex with anyone before. She has waited for her husband, and now he's enjoying that. And so that's what verse 12 is. And then he describes her in verses 13 through 15 as a wonderland of sensual delight. I told you, this book wasn't really for young people. I mean, you know, there's an age limit here. But he describes her as a wonderland of sensual delight. She's like the best of fruits in his mouth. You know, just unbelievable. And she's a mixture of the most beautiful fragrances on earth. So all of these things you see, these are sensory things. He's not going to be vulgar. He's going to portray this sensual experience in these kinds of terms. And so that's what he's doing here. She's as delightful as a garden spring. You see, that's constantly providing refreshing and life-giving water that streams down from the mountain ranges of Lebanon. You see, that's something that's very pleasing, life-giving. And this may also speak to her physical readiness for sexual activity. That's all I'm saying. All right. Now, we would use, again, different metaphors, but you cannot miss. You can't miss how into his bride he is and how he's aching to be intimate with her. This is what he's after. Then in verse 16, the woman now, she now expresses the desire that her husband recognize her readiness and now enter into her, described poetically as his coming into her garden and eating its choice fruits. You see, I mean, this is tastefully done. But she's ready. She's saying it is time. You see, she wants this, you know, this idea of this north wind, send the signal so that he recognizes I'm ready. And it says, blow my garden, let its spices flow, let my love come into his garden and eat its choice fruits. Okay, that's we're talking about sexual intimacy. And this is in marriage. This is what the woman is expressing, and it's portrayed, as I said, tastefully. Coming into the, as she says, and in 5:1, it portrays this. The man says, I come to my garden. See, my garden, my sister, my bride. I gather my myrrh with my spice. I eat my honeycomb with my honey. I drink my wine with my milk. This is a tasteful way, you see, of portraying their sexual union. His coming to his garden to enjoy all of its sensual pleasures. So here you have now, we have the marriage, and we have the consummation of the marriage. What had been they've been longing for so long. And then we have the daughters of Jerusalem eat, friends, drink, and be drunk with caresses. The daughters of Jerusalem, who in chapter 1, verse 4, do you remember they expressed their intent there to celebrate the couple's marital union? They said that there. Well, they now do so. They celebrate that. They rejoice in the marital bliss of the newlyweds. See, urging them to enjoy the occasion and to enjoy each other's bodies. Be drunk with caresses. See, urging them to do that. To celebrate it and to experience this. They're happy for them. And as I said, with regard to chapter 1, verse 4, the one flesh union of marriage, it's a good thing. You see, it's a blessing from God. It's a wonderful thing to be experienced, to be enjoyed. And the community of faith, as represented by the maidens, the friends, people who love the couple, as they're married, they celebrate with them because they're happy that they've come together and are able to experience all the blessings of marriage. And so this is what they're doing. They're celebrating with them, saying, enjoy. As I said, this is so different from the celibacy stuff that you see in the early church. You see this notion of the rightness and goodness and blessedness of sexual experience within the bonds of marriage. And as I said then too, you know, the caricature of Christians, how they try to portray Christians, this is the enemy doing this, to try to portray Christians as though they have some kind of hang-up, is how they put it. No hang-up. Just understand self-control and that gift is given for exercise in that committed relationship. And so here, when that happens, it's joy for everybody. Everybody celebrates. Good, enjoy each other. Just enjoy each other. Don't be guilty. Enjoy. Don't let these things that you've heard. You're married, you enjoy. Okay, so that's what I think there. You see that going on. And 5:2, 5:2 to 8 says, the woman says, I was asleep, but my heart was awake. Okay, so she's dreaming. She's in a semi-conscious state. She says, I'm asleep, but something's revved. Listen, my love is knocking. The man, open to me, my sister, my darling, my dove, my perfect one. My head is drenched with dew, my hair with the dampness of the night. Woman, I've taken off my tunic. How can I put it on again? I've washed my feet. How can I dirty them again? My love thrust his hand through the latch opening, and my heart was thrilled within me. I arose to open to my love, and my hands dripped with myrrh, my fingers with flowing myrrh on the handles of the bolt. I opened to my love, but my love had turned and gone. You see, this sense of how this works in dreams, my heart sank, literally my soul went out. My heart sank at his departure. I sought him, but did not find him. I called him, but he did not answer. The watchmen found me as they went about in the city. They beat me. They bruised me. They took away my cloak, those watchmen of the walls. I charge you, O daughters of Jerusalem, if you find my love, what will you tell him? That I'm sick from love. Ah, what's going on here? Now, while the woman slept, it says her mind, literally it's her heart representing her mind and her emotions. It was awake, which suggests, as I said, she's either dreaming, she's in a semi-conscious state. She's not awake, and this isn't something that's just happening. The fact she says she's asleep, she hears her love knocking on the door and calling to her to let him in. And he speaks lovingly to her. And he indicates to her that he's traveled through the night to get to her. That's why his hair is wet with dew, which speaks of the strength of his desire for her. So he's here, traveled all night, came through, he's covered in dew, made that journey to get to her, and she responds in verse 3 to her love's appeal, as I see this, by playfully putting him off and fanning his flame by mentioning that she's already in bed in her underwear. She says, I've taken my tunic off. And so here he comes, talking to her. Hey, dear, how could I possibly get up? You know, I'm just sitting here mostly naked. How could I possibly get up and dirty my feet? I think this is just playful, and I think it's a way of fanning his flame. Well, after that, you know, he's ready to come through the door. That's why you see this. It says, my love thrusts his hand through the door. Well, he's ready. She's up. You know, I don't know. It'd be hard for me to walk across that floor. I don't know. You know, I'm here. Just took my tunic off, and I don't know if I can do that. This guy wants in. You see, he's ready. He's ready to come to you. He reaches his hand through the latch opening. Perhaps he's opening the door, hoping the door's not locked. And the woman's excited by the prospect of their impending union. I mean, she's excited. Her heart's thrilled. She's got, you know, dripped with myrrh and flowing with myrrh. I mean, she's all perfect. She's ready. She's excited about this. Yet, as happens in dreams, when she opens the door in verse 6, he's gone. Right? You saw this in the other dreams. That's the way dreams are. He's gone. Then he shows up. So he's gone. Now, I think this absence, I think the absence is created here by the poet to depict the woman's desire for her man in their marriage relationship. That's what I think is going on here. See, after they have experienced each other sexually, see, that desire, that's reflected in her despair that he's departed, in her seeking after him when he's not there. She goes and looks for him, and in her disappointment in not finding him. See, their having been sexually intimate in marriage has not diminished or extinguished their desire for each other, as though it's a case of been there, done that. That's not how it is. And I think this separation is to paint that idea that it's not that way. That it's not, you're all revved up, you're just on fire, you get married, you spend a bit of time together, and that's it. I now no longer have this sexual pull and bond to my spouse. That's not it at all. See, she still has this intense longing for him, and it's represented here, it comes out in this dream, where he's gone, and she's longing for him. See, on the contrary, having shared in the one flesh union of marriage, their bond is so close, and thus their desire for each other is so great, that being separated from her man now produces even more distress and pain than did her separation during their betrothal. Do you remember how that was? That she was out there and she had a similar thing. She's walking along. Have you seen him? Talks to the watchman. But in that case, they didn't beat her. You see, so here I think what it is depicting, the poet is saying, listen, that far from the idea that having gotten together diminishes this, it is not the case at all that now the separation from him is even more painful. It has enhanced their union, their intimacy, their closeness, because they've shared what only men and women in marriage share. And so that's what I think he's after. See, that symbolized, I said, her being beaten and abused by the watchman, unlike what had happened in her dream in chapter 3, verse 3. And it's also symbolized in her charge to the daughters of Jerusalem to tell her love that she's lovesick in the event they succeed in finding him. Will you tell him I'm jonesing? Okay, well, why? What's up? Well, that's my husband. And I'm into him even more. You're saying there's a lesson to be learned. I'm telling you, there's a lesson to be learned in our society and culture that's all through here. Ignore that. All right. Daughters of Jerusalem, how is your beloved better than another beloved, most beautiful of women? How is your beloved better than another beloved that you charge us this way? Now here we have the daughters of Jerusalem, and the woman then responds and says, my love is radiant and ruddy, outstanding among 10,000. His head is purest gold, his hair is wavy, black as a raven. His eyes are like doves beside streams of water, bathed in milk and fitly set. His cheeks are like garden beds of balsam trees, towers of spices. His lips are lilies dripping, flowing myrrh. His arms are rods of gold set with topaz. His abdomen is polished ivory, bedecked with lapis lazuli. His legs are alabaster columns set on bases of gold. His appearance is like Lebanon, choice as the cedars. His mouth is most sweet, and he's altogether desirable. This is my love, and this is my friend, O daughters of Jerusalem. This is my love, and this is my friend, O daughters of Jerusalem. See, the daughters of Jerusalem, they set the woman up to brag about the man she loves, and they invite her to reflect on the attributes that have so captivated her. This is what they want to do. So what's so special about him that you're lovesick? You know, what's the deal with him? I mean, why is he so special? And so they're serving this up to her so she can go ahead and brag on him. And in addressing her as most beautiful of women, they repeat the man's description of her in chapter 1, verse 8. And perhaps that serves to remind her of his deep appreciation of her beauty. But then the woman describes her love here, describes him in these poetical terms that reflect how she feels about him. You see, he is her idealized Superman. She has the greatest appreciation for him, just crazy about him. And so this is how she sees him in all of these things here. You know, this physical description and all of that, she's just crazy about it. In her eyes, he looks amazing. He smells amazing. He's a complete delight to kiss. She just is absolutely crazy. She says he is altogether desirable. This guy, you know, I like, you know, cleaned house when I pick this guy. And that's how she feels. And I got to tell you, I know her man's loving this. You see, he's liking this feeling. And so this is how she feels about him. But beyond his physical attractiveness, he's her soulmate. You see, and that's when, you know, this would be completely different if you simply talked about physical attraction. Part of the joy of the bonding and all is the uniting of soul. It is the two people. That's what intimacy is. You see, it has a physical component to it, but if there's not the emotional soul component to it, you're missing a large chunk of it. And so here's a person who recognizes that, and she says he's her soulmate, her love, and her friend. You see, as he refers to her as what? His sister. Not in some way like, oh, you got him with his sister. No. No, it's the relationship. That's what they're talking about. And so she has this toward him. He has this towards her. And so this is marriage. This is the bond that you see in the two people. And then we have here in 6:1, I know that bell's going to ring, the daughters of Jerusalem. They say, where has your love gone, O most beautiful of women? Where has your love turned that we may seek him with you? So we're still in the dream. And we're saying, you know, look, you're looking for him. We need some direction. We can't just go out and do whatever, you know, house to house. We got to tell us, where was he? You know, give me a quadrant. Let me know somewhere that he is. She says, my love has gone down to his garden, to beds of spice, to graze in the gardens and gather lilies. I am my love's and my love is mine. He grazes among the lilies. You see, they ask for the general direction so they can help her locate. And again, this is dream. They can help. They obviously can't search everywhere. They need some focus. And then suddenly, and without explanation, as happens in dreams, the distressing separation is over. It's over, and the man and woman are back together in sexual intimacy. So see, this is in here, I think, to show the power and the attraction is not diminished, it is enhanced by sharing in what God has given in marriage. So it's not a case like that. So here it's even greater. The separation causes more pain to show that it hasn't been extinguished by sharing each other in marriage. And so then we wind up, you know, it hasn't diminished that love. And one other thing, I heard the second bell. But another point is that, so you have that desire for each other, but it's also, see, the marriage has freed them from the frustration that accompanied the betrothal. You see, in the betrothal, they had all this and this power and this stuff, but it couldn't be satisfied. You see, so now we have a picture of not only is this love not extinguished by the sexual intimacy of marriage, it's enhanced, but also that power, don't fear, because in marriage, that pull and that power can be wonderfully and beautifully satisfied. Unlike in the betrothal, where they had to remain frustrated until the right time. All right, I heard that bell. Thanks for coming.